I see you. You've got a test tomorrow, and you're going to have to label and explain the function of the parts of a cell. So take a screenshot of this and take a screenshot of that. And I'm going to tell you about the cell with some cool details to help you remember the parts. Okay, first of all, what defines the cell? Like, what makes it the cell as opposed to anything else in the universe? I know you know this. It's shown here with number one, referring to this boundary going all the way around. What's that called? That is the cell or the plasma membrane. You may also see it as the plasma lemma if you've got a really old book. A book? What am I talking about? That's why you're here. The membrane stuff is really important. You will probably have to know a lot more about them. So I've got some videos on those. By the way, this is a great opportunity for me to ask you to show me some love. Just take a second. It doesn't cost you anything, and it really helps me to keep making videos like this for you. Okay, thanks. Next, what is inside the cell? So what gives it shape and what allows it to move? Okay, I know you know this one. Number two, this refers to all the yellow stuff inside the cell. What is that? It's not air, it's cytoplasm. Okay, so it's this kind of gel-like fluid. It's like the soup of the cell. That's where all the organelles are floating. Okay, next, 3, 5, and 6. Collectively, these are referred to as the cytoskeleton, literally just cell skeleton. So these are going to be fibers. The smallest of them we call microfilaments. And these little guys, they're called centrioles, and they're actually made of the second type of fiber called microtubules. Microtubules are the biggest one. And the centrioles actually assist in organizing other microtubules into what we call a spindle during cell division. In between microfilaments and microtubules in size, we have, yeah, intermediate filaments. Sometimes the names make sense. So if you have seen microvilli, the really fuzzy border on some types of epithelia, those are made of microfilaments. Intermediate filaments are about mechanical strength, so we find them in things like keratin in the skin, as well as muscle. And microtubules, as I was mentioning before, these are big ones, and they're important for intracellular transport, and my personal favorite, cilia and flagella. The only human flagellated cells are sperm. And they are so cute. The tails of the sperm are made of microtubules. Okay, let's talk about the organelles now. So organelle just means little organ. What is the brain of the cell, the headquarters? You probably know this already. So we've got a few things over here. Number 7 is this entire structure, the headquarters of the cell. That's the nucleus. Number 8 is the slightly darker shaded area. That's the nucleolus. And number 9, that looks kind of like spaghetti, that's chromatin. So let's talk about those. So the nucleus is bound by a double membrane called the nuclear envelope, and it's got holes in it, which we call nuclear pores, because holes isn't a very sciencey word. Now, I know you know that the nucleus contains DNA, but the DNA doesn't float around all by itself. It's actually complexed with proteins called histones. And together we call that complex chromatin. You can't see it under the light microscope, but that's what the DNA usually looks like, unless the cell is dividing. Next, we have this nucleolus. This is the darkest staining region, and that's actually where ribosomal RNA is made. We're going to talk about ribosomes next, so hang tight. But first, I wanted to show you this transmission electron micrograph of an animal cell nucleus. It's so pretty. Okay, next, where are proteins made? Do you remember those? Okay, shown here as the little red dots. Those are ribosomes. And you might also remember that ribosomes can exist either floating freely in the cell or attached to other structures, these membranes. So really quick, kind of the order of events, this will help you to understand the organelles and remember them. Inside the nucleus, we have the DNA. The DNA will get transcribed. So we make a copy, looks a little different, but carries the same language. We call that messenger RNA. The messenger RNA can leave the nucleus and it goes out into the cytoplasm and finds itself a ribosome. And the ribosome is where that code, the messenger RNA, is going to be translated into a protein. So these ribosomes are where that translation occurs. Now we have what are called endomembrane systems. That just means membranes inside, where proteins and lipids are going to be made. Number 11 are the membranes that are studded with ribosomes. Do you know what those are called? Those are rough endoplasmic reticulum. It is a long word, I know. Number 12, these are membranes that look more like tubes rather than stacks of membranes, and they don't have ribosomes. So we call those smooth endoplasmic reticulum. Now, you probably know the rough versus smooth is about ribosomes, but there's some other differences too. So the structure of the rough ER we call cisternae. Those are flattened sacs. A cistern is like a reservoir, whereas smooth ER is more tubular. In terms of function, rough ER is all about protein, whereas smooth ER is all about lipids, detox, and in muscle cells, also calcium storage. Rough ER is most abundant in cells that make a lot of proteins, that makes sense. And smooth ER is abundant in cells that do lipid metabolism, detoxification, so that would be especially like the liver, and muscle cells. Relationship to Golgi, I'm going to show you in just a second. So where do the cell products get packaged? Often they get activated, labeled, and prepared for export. People teach it as the postal annex or the Amazon distribution center of the cell. Number 13, do you recognize those? Yeah, those are called Golgi bodies or the Golgi apparatus. And number 14, these are pinched off portions of Golgi called Golgi vesicles. Okay, big picture here. Nucleus is the headquarters. That's going to contain the code to make the protein. The rough endoplasmic reticulum, that's the production center. The Golgi bodies are the packing and distribution centers. So it is like a factory, and the process is linear. So usually the products that come out of the rough ER are not in their final form. We call them precursors or immature products. Sometimes they're called cargo. In the Golgi, they will be processed, labeled, activated. A lot of chemistry goes on here. And then finished products will pinch off, leave the Golgi in these secretory vesicles, usually for cellular export. So because it works this way, you may also have to know that the Golgi have these two faces, what we call the cis face, meaning the side facing the rough ER, and the trans face, which faces the plasma membrane. Remember, cis means same, and trans just means across. The Golgi are made of stacks of membranes, those cisternae, and the inside of each membrane cistern we call a lumen. Okay, you got it? That's a lot, I know. We're making good progress here. Where does the energy for all of this come from? You know this one. Number 15, the energy powerhouse of the cell, that is a mitochondrion. And mitochondria are responsible for cellular respiration, basically turning the energy from the food we eat into energy the cell can use in the form of ATP. Where do the cell products get stored and excreted? These are easy. So number 16 here, this is just called a vacuole. And number 17 is called a secretory vesicle. That is where exocytosis, or what I like to call cell barfing, takes place. We are almost done. We've just got to talk about waste and recycling. 18 and 19, we've got lysosomes and peroxisomes. They look very much the same, even under electron microscopy, and they are both organelles that are filled with enzymes, but they do slightly different things. So lysosomes form as pinched off organelles from the Golgi bodies, and they basically degrade worn out cellular parts. This is called autophagy, which means self-eating. They also destroy foreign invaders, so they're really abundant in white blood cells, for example, which are the key players in the immune response. Now, lysosomes contain a lot of hydrolases. These are enzymes that catalyze hydrolysis reactions where big, complicated things are being broken down. Proteases break down proteins. Amylases break down polysaccharides, lipases break down lipids. You get the idea. Now, peroxisomes form as pinched off organelles from smooth ER, and they are master chemists, and they're responsible for a lot of our detox reactions. So they're really abundant in places like the liver. Peroxisomes contain a lot of oxidases, so they catalyze oxidation reactions. Do you recognize this? That's ethanol. Some of you may have experienced ethanol. And when you consume ethanol, peroxisomes will take it and combine it with hydrogen peroxide. And that forms acetaldehyde and water. And it is acetaldehyde that causes all of the glorious side effects of a hangover. Nausea, vomiting, tachycardia, sweating, skin flush, fatigue, headache, increased sensitivity to light and sound, muscle aches, dry mouth, anxiety, irritability. Yeah, maybe you've read about it. Oh, and by the way, if you've studied this already, take a second, pause the video, and see if you can identify who's being oxidized and who's being reduced. Did you get it? If not, check out this video. And that's it. You did it. Not so bad. As always, I hope that was helpful. Thank you so much for visiting the Penguin Prof channel. Please take a second, show me some love, slam those buttons. I'll see you in the next one. Good luck.